Hi, Bartonella buddies. Biofilms are a serious problem. They're actually one of the main reasons why treating Bartonellosis is so difficult, and since I've been a patient with Bartonellosis for 3 years, I've learned a lot about them. By the end of this video, you're going to know what biofilms are, what we know about Bartonella biofilms specifically, and what we can take as patients to combat biofilms. If you're new to my channel, my name is Jake, and I like to help patients become their own best advocates. So, what are biofilms? Biofilms are basically colonies of microorganisms that are held together by a sticky substance that the microorganisms themselves produce. The sticky substance is made up of proteins, lipids, and polysaccharides, and that forms a matrix that basically just holds it all together. Most, if not all, microorganisms actually make biofilms, including fungus like Candida, but today we're just going to focus on bacterial biofilms. Biofilms are found everywhere from pond scum to the human body. And some humans are pond scum. Some biofilms you can see with your naked eye instead of your clothed eye. Some biofilms you can see with your naked eye, like plaque on your teeth, and other biofilms are microscopic. Researchers now believe that actually most bacteria on Earth live in a biofilm state. So you can think of biofilms of little societies in which the bacteria work together to survive better, just like humans live in societies where we can care for each other, learn from each other, and look out for one another. Or stab each other in each other's backs. Or leave each other out to rot. Is my misanthropy showing? That was my major. Biofilms are like little houses that protect the bacteria inside from the human's immune system and antibiotics. They also help bacteria exchange nutrients more easily, and when the bacteria sense a change in the environment, they help each other survive and adapt by exchanging DNA.
Is that like swapping spit?
And communicating via chemicals. There's a common misconception that antibiotics can't penetrate biofilms, and that's what makes treating biofilm infections so difficult, but this is a gross oversimplification. Some antibiotics are better at penetrating biofilms than other antibiotics, and some biofilms are better at keeping antibiotics out. Even antibiotics that rapidly enter a biofilm don't always cause significant bacterial death, so antibiotic penetration is just one factor. So a second factor is that there are enzymes in biofilms that can actually break down certain antibiotics. And a third one is there is DNA that is located outside of the bacteria but within the biofilm. And the way that this protects the bacteria is in multiple ways. One way is that this DNA might stand in between antibiotics and the bacterial cells, so that protects them. This DNA also helps bacteria swap DNA with each other, and this is the main way that bacteria develop resistance to antibiotics. So basically, the bacteria are like, hey, I figured out how to survive this antibiotic, take my secret code so that you can survive too. So in a biofilm, the bacteria that are on the outside have the most access to nutrients and oxygen and are the most active, while the cells on the inside of the biofilm are oxygen deprived and have a slower metabolism. And this slower metabolism part is actually really, really important because many antibiotics work by interfering with bacterial metabolism. So this means that antibiotics are going to be less effective against these more asleep or metabolically less active bacteria in the center of the biofilm. And biofilms protect bacteria from our immune systems. One way is that it acts as a physical barrier so that our immune cells can't detect and eliminate the bacteria. It's also important to note that bacteria have evolved over millions of years to take advantage of immune systems. Bacteria can actually release molecules that attract our white blood cells to the area, and then the white blood cells lodge an attack, and that can have collateral damage to the tissue. The bacteria have then tricked or outsmarted our immune system into damaging our own tissue, which then they can take advantage of to make more or a better biofilm. And then this can cause chronic inflammation. I am the definition of that when you look it up in the dictionary. Maybe you are too. See you there. On the page. Who uses a dictionary anymore though, really? Like, it's all online. So see you on the webpage! So now, let's move on to what we know about Bartonella biofilms specifically. Nothing! Goodbye! We do know that biofilms are one of the main reasons that makes Bartonellosis so difficult to treat. And this is pretty interesting. Bartonella can form biofilms in humans, but it also can form biofilms in the fleeces of the cat flea.
Fleeces?
Fleeces of the cat flea! In fact, once Barnilla is excreted into the flea feces, they replicate and create a biofilm and can survive in the flea feces for up to 10 days. One of the main ways that Bartonella creates a biofilm is it has this protein on the outside that allows it to stick to the cells that line our blood vessels and collagen. And these are both places where Bartonella has been visualized using high-tech microscopy. And then these biofilms periodically release Bartonella bacteria into the bloodstream so that the f*** you. And then these biofilms periodically release bacterial cells into the bloodstream so that they can go and colonize new parts of the body. This is called imperialism. So what can we do to address Bartonella biofilms specifically? Well, there isn't any research on this as far as I'm aware. I mean, maybe there is on endocarditis? Don't know. But most of the research we do have is on other pathogens, so we're just gonna have to go off that, which has a lot of caveats. Number one, antibiotics. Antibiotics can actually work against biofilms outside of their killing capacity. The antibiotic class of macrolides, which includes clarithromycin and azithromycin, which are both commonly used in the treatment of Bartonellosis, have actually been shown to inhibit bacterial communication within a biofilm. Macrolides can actually inhibit the communication of bacteria that they don't actually have good antimicrobial activity against. And remember, biofilms are made up of proteins, lipids, and sugar molecules.
It's sugar how you get so fly.
Sugar how you get so fly. Sugar how you get so fly.
And macrolides can actually decrease the amount of sugar molecules in a biofilm, which then weakens the structure. And this allows for better penetration of antibiotics and perhaps better penetration of our own immune cells. Number two, enzymes. One of the most common compounds used by members in our Breaking Down Bartonella support group on Facebook use a supplement called lumbrokinase. According to our members, this is what Dr. Moziani and Dr. Marty Ross are using and probably other BLMDs. Lumbrokinase is an enzyme, and you can tell that it's an enzyme because it has the suffix ace, and it's made from earthworms.
Now, how does that happen?
I don't know. This is a picture of the earthworms that they... Earthworms.
This is a picture of the earthworms that they use. Delicious.
Lumbrokinase breaks down fibrin, and this is really important in terms of Bartonellosis, and you'll know this if you watched my video on how Bartonella causes symptoms. If you haven't watched that video yet, there is still time to redeem yourself and repent heavily. Fibrin is part of the clotting process, and it is basically a glue-like protein that creates a mesh that can trap bacterial cells so that they don't spread to the rest of the body, but it can also impede blood flow, and this is one of the ways that Bartonella can cause symptoms ranging from foot pain to neuropsychiatric symptoms. And we often think of biofilms as sticking to a surface like the lining of our blood vessels, but they can actually break off and just be floating around, like in this picture. Here are some examples of brands of lumbrokinase that have been recommended to the patients in our group by their doctors. And if you're wondering whether lumbrokinase has any research behind it to support that it does dissolve fibrin, the answer is yes. There's an article that was published in Nature, and they discuss how lumbrokinase has anti-fibrin activities, anticoagulant activity, antioxidant, and anti-inflammatory properties. Lumbrokinase seems to be the favorite right now among BLMDs, but they also use serrapeptase and nattokinase, and both of those are also enzymes that can break down fibrin and act as anticoagulants. BLMDs often instruct their patients to take these enzymes on an empty stomach about 30 minutes before a meal. Number three, NAC. This is another BLMD favorite, and NAC stands for N-acetylcysteine, and it's the supplement form of cysteine, which is an amino acid. Cysteine is an antioxidant, and it's also a precursor to glutathione, the body's major antioxidant. NAC is used to thin mucus, and I can attest to this. I recently took NAC after not taking it for a while, and then I laid down to have a nap, and I woke up choking on my own mucus. Obviously, I survived. NAC has been shown to have some antimicrobial activity and to decrease biofilm formation. I personally use the Pure Encapsulations brand, and I use a low dose, but some BLMDs instruct their patients to go up to 1200 milligrams twice a day. But remember, this is not medical advice, because I'm not a doctor. I've seen patients in our group go higher, but remember, higher is not always better. Dispersing and degrading biofilms can release more bacteria into the bloodstream than your body can handle, and it can start a very inflammatory immune response. 4. NSAIDs. Some BLMDs recommend baby aspirin for biofilms and symptom management. Aspirin is an NSAID, an anti-inflammatory, and a blood thinner. We know that many of the symptoms caused by Bartonella are due to inflammation and blood flow, so we can see how NSAIDs work to reduce Bartonella symptoms like aspirin and ibuprofen. These drugs are salicylates, and salicylates are derived from salicylic acid, which is found in a wide variety of foods, including fruits and vegetables. Fun fact, plants make salicylates to protect themselves from insects, fungus, and disease. Salicylates have been shown to interfere with a pathogen's ability to adhere to a surface, and this is a key step. It's also the first step in biofilm formation. And studies have shown this with bacteria like E. coli and fungus like Candida albicans. 5. Allicin and liposomal oil of oregano. Many people in our group are using allicin, which is an extract of garlic, and liposomal oil of oregano to treat Bartonellosis. So there is a study that came from researchers at Johns Hopkins showing that the essential oil of oregano did have good antimicrobial activity. Did I say in vitro? It was in vitro, against Bartonella. And as far as I know, there isn't any literature to support antimicrobial activity of allicin against Bartonella. But anecdotally and clinically, according to their doctors, patients are having some success with allicin. And we do have studies showing that allicin does have antimicrobial activity just against other pathogens. Allicin has been shown to have anti-biofilm properties against bacteria like staph species and fungus like Candida albicans. And oil of oregano has been shown to have anti-biofilm properties against staph species and E. coli and probably other bacteria. So based on this research and BLMD experience, it seems like allicin and oil of oregano may have antibacterial activity and or antibiofilm activity in those with Bartonellosis. To learn more about the treatment of Bartonellosis, I have put my best videos on this topic in a playlist for you. So just click right here or else I'm gonna start singing.
Sugar, how you get so fly. Ooh.